제 경험상 단순히 이제 내가 취미로 게임을 취미로 즐기는 개념으로 대회를 나간다든지 이렇게 해서는 절대 할 수 없고 부단한 정말 하루에 대부분의 시간을 투자해야 되고 승리를 하기 위해서 전략을 구상해야 되고 거기에 맞춰서 그 전략을 수행하기 위해서 엄청난 노력이 들어가는 것.
I followed the world of competitive video games for more than a dozen years now, both professionally as well as just a personal fan. I've also followed the world of traditional sports ever since I've been a sentient human being, so please keep that in mind when I tell you, I have never before seen a sports organization like the Afrika Freaks. On the surface, they may not seem too different from the many other Korean pro gaming organizations out there, a group of dedicated players who spend as much time as they physically can honing their craft. That's not unique, that's to be expected, and when I was invited to come out to Korea and meet and interview the team earlier this year, I expected that I was just going to be making a run-of-the-mill documentary on another pro gaming team, same as any other. But the more I learned about the team and the players, the more I learned these guys are remarkably different from what you might expect. This is not just another esports team. This is a team piloted by legendary esports figureheads who could not be less interested in their own personal histories.
과거의 유물들은 좀 지우는 편입니다. 그래서 집에서 우승 트로피나 이런 것들을 버려요, 저는.
They're a team filled with some of the best position players alive, yet they've never won a championship themselves.
지금 와서도 생각해보면 좀 아쉬움이 큰 것 같아요. 저는 개인적으로 4강 이상 바라고 있었는데 좀 아쉬움이 큰 그런 해였던 것 같아요.
This is a team that has broken every industry rule and has attempted to do things that no other Korean team has in the history of competitive league, yet hardly anyone in the world knows about it or gives them the recognition they deserve. Well, today I'm going to try and finally shed some light on a few of these stories and give some insight that the world has yet to learn about this weird pro gaming team that behaves like they're anything but that. I just hope I can do it all justice. In early 2017, a young Korean League of Legends player was rising up the ranks of solo queue on the competitive ladder. He was talented and thought that he played pretty well, so he began to have aspirations of playing professionally. There was just one problem. He had no idea how to get started. Making the jump from someone who just plays games casually in the comfort of their own home to being on a professional team, that's a weird transition that doesn't have a clear-cut path, so naturally he was at a bit of a loss. After mulling things over and considering what he should do, he came up with the idea to just go and ask a pro team how they find players to sign. In the Korean League of Legends circuit, there's two main leagues, the LCK and Challengers Korea. LCK is the top league of competition that every player aspires to become champion in one day. The league below that, otherwise known as CK, is a sort of semi-pro or amateur league. This is where newcomers often get their career start, and for most of LoL's history, there's also been a promotion relegation series at the end of each season, where the best teams from the CK get to face off against the worst LCK teams. Winners get to play in the top league next split. Well, this young Korean player bought a ticket for one of the Challengers Korea events, hoping to gain some insight from one of the semi-pro teams there. After all the day's games had finished, he eventually found a staff member for one of the teams participating, Ever8 Winners, and just asked the guy straight up, "How do players go pro?" The staff member responded, "Well, most teams do tryouts for players they think are good. Do you want to try out with us?" "Yeah, I would like that." And the rest of the story, as they say, was history. This young player named Kim Gi-in, who went by the in-game handle Keen, was now a professional. Ever8 Winners would end up winning that CK split and was promoted into LCK, where Keen immediately started as their new top laner for the summer season. The year was rough for the young team, as they would finish bottom of the league and would be demoted back down to the CK again, but one other LCK team noticed Keen's potential. Right before the start of the 2018 season, that team, the Afrika Freaks, took a chance on this unproven rookie and decided to sign him. This would pay off in spades. Today, Keane is considered one of the best players in the world, and personally, I don't think there's a better top laner out there. He most recently won the MVP award at the 2019 Kespa Cup, and in 2018, he was voted as Korea's best top laner to represent the region at the Asian Games main event. Keane is actually considered one of the best players in League of Legends, period. Korean League fans have a saying, the best League of Legends team that can exist is five Keens. This comes from the fact that Keane can play any one of the game's five roles phenomenally well. At one point during the 2019 spring split, Afrika was having some trouble with their mid laners performing poorly. So during a practice set, they asked Keane if he could try and play mid lane for them. He responded, sure. For the match, he decided to play the champion Orianna, which he ended up destroying his opponents with her, carrying Afrika to a very easy win with a score of 10 kills, 1 death, and 8 assists. Afterwards, the team asked him why he never told them that he could play Orianna so well, to which he responded, that's the second time I've played her. Keane is celebrated for his incredible savant-like skill, but for as good as he is, he's also one of the youngest players on Afrika right now, only 20 years old. Naturally, when I got to sit down and talk with him one-on-one, the very first question I asked was, what do his parents think? Do they know that their son is the best top laner in the world?
이제 프로게이머 생활을 하다 보면 이제 연습 때문에 조금 늦게 자게 되는 경우가 있는데 아직 늦게 자게 되면 그걸 좀 아직 이해는 해주시는데 어느 정도 이해를 좀 하기 어려우신 부분이 있는 것 같고 이제 그냥 지금까지 해놓은 업적들을 이제 보시면은 항상 이제는 자랑스러워 하시는 것 같아요. 네.
One of the surprising things about Keane is typically a player of his talent is courted by foreign teams every single offseason. Many North American and Chinese organizations in particular are known for throwing millions of dollars at superstar Korean pros just like him. Plenty of players take these offers and leave their home to go play for these foreign teams since it's huge money for them, and sometimes the competition in other regions is just flat out easier. But Keane doesn't seem interested in this kind of opportunity at all, no matter how tough the road ahead is in Korea.
이제 당연히 한국에서 하면은 이제 개인적으로 편한 게 있어서 좋겠지만 이제 저도 해외에서 이제 한다는 그런 로망 같은 걸 갖고 있었는데 아무래도 지금 이 나이에 해외를 가버리면 이제 국내에서 LCK에서 못 이룬 그런 게 좀 나중에 조금 후회할 것 같아서 사람들이 오래오래 기억해 줬으면 좋겠어요.
From the years 2013 to 2017, the nation of South Korea had one of their teams win every single world championship 5 years running. And in 2018, Afrika were proudly one of the three best Korean teams that got to represent the region at that year's Worlds. They qualified through championship points, meaning they placed fairly highly in a few events throughout the year, so they were awarded a qualifying spot based on consistently good play, but they hadn't ever won the Korean League themselves. At this tournament, the other Korean teams accompanying Afrika faltered pretty hard. The former world champions, Gen G, ended up getting embarrassed in the group stage when they were knocked out after winning only one match out of the six they played, the worst performance a Korean team has ever had. This just left Afrika and KT Rolster as the only two remaining Korean teams. Both teams managed to make it into the knockout stage, but on day one, KT was beaten in a close 3-2 set against a Chinese team, Invictus Gaming. This meant if Korea was going to win Worlds this year, it would be off the backs of Afrika. This put a huge amount of pressure on them. They were a team who had never won anything before, but it also meant that there were no other Korean teams in their way. They could make their very first tournament championship a world championship if they could just win the next few sets.
Even stop the Baron as the Smite. Wow, he gets to kill the jungler. Who's gonna get it? Oh. You've gotta be kidding me! Licorice solo carrying this game. They're still
taking the front line. They're going right now into the back line. It's low for Keen, but he's gonna stay alive. Ornhorn calls, and they're gonna find a knockup. Will they get any kills? That Spirit gone already. Jensen finds the back line, looking for Tushin. He's low, looking for Kramer. He's under.
What the heart? Oh, they're going for it!
Oh, what a hook by Tushin! They're gonna find the way in, though. The Ornn's gonna come across, and the knockups are there! Is this the fight? It's 2-0, and the Guardian Angels are popped! This could well be it! Look at them clean up the map, and the last vestige of Korea has been destroyed! Cloud9 will make it to the semifinals! A 3-0 sweep!
한국팀 성적이 이제 2017년까지는 다 한국팀이 롤드컵 우승을 하고 있었던 때였는데 이제 2018년에 마침 저희가 딱 8강에서 떨어져서 개인적으로 그때는 실패라고 생각을 했었는데 지금 와서도 생각해보면 좀 아쉬움이 큰 것 같아요. 저는 개인적으로 4강 이상 바라고 있었는데 좀 아쉬움이 큰 그런 해였던 것 같아요.
See, this is one of the things I love about Africa. They're essentially a Shakespearean tragedy. Leading up to this Worlds, it was reported by ESPN that Africa had been practicing twice as much as any other team, going to levels of near sleep deprivation. They practiced for so many hours that when Western players heard how much time they spent scrimmaging, they felt bad for them. There wasn't another team at this World Championship who worked harder to make their country proud, but all they would be remembered for was the team that C9 beat. It was around this period of time that many people started criticizing Africa as a team who was wasting the talent of legendary players like Keen. How could a team that finished fifth in the LCK even be worthy of a spot at Worlds, people asked. For all the work and effort they put in, this was now their reward. What really shocks me about this series of events more than anything, though, was the fact that Keen decided to stay with Africa and recently signed an extension. At this point, Africa hadn't ever won anything, and with his talents, he could go off and join some super team who had a better chance of winning a world championship, but that's not the kind of person he is.
이제 저는 아프리카 프릭스라는 팀을 이제 떠오르면 이제 제가 떠오르는 게 가장 기쁘다고 생각을 하고 이제 더 앞으로 더 열심히 해서 이제 아프리카 프릭스라는 팀을 해외에 좀 더 알리기 위해서 좋은 성적 내서 열심히 해야 될 것 같아요.
Keen may seem pretty impressive, and he has a bit of experience under his belt now, but he's still a really young kid, only 20 years old. People are already labeling him a future legend of esports, but Africa also has an actual esports legend to help younger players like him along.
CCV! 야 이번 피해만큼은 받아서는 안 될 피해인데요.
아 탱크 두기가 다르고
그냥 피해 한미도도 질러 들어가 그냥 붙어요. 야 질러 나 빼지 아드목게만 질러들이 전달된
결정적으로 테란이 이래서 정말 힘들다 치면 그럼 아래 본진과 또한테 본진이야.
Before League of Legends was released, the nation of Korea was still in love with esports, just with a different game, namely StarCraft Brood War. Ever since its release in 1998, competitive leagues for the game have existed and been broadcast on Korean TV as the nation eagerly competed to see who the best player in the world was. Many different players would manage to win tournaments, but there eventually came to be five players who rose above the rest. These gods of the game earned the title Bonjwa. Bonjwa was a title given by the StarCraft community to players who weren't just good, but players who were so good and pushed the metagame forward so far that they defined the era that they played in. One of these players was a Terran player named I Love Uv, sometimes referred to simply as Uv. He is currently the head coach of the Africa Freaks.
저 같은 경우는 가장 어렸을 때 슈퍼 컴보이라고 집에서 팩 게임이 있어요. 오락 그 일본 아마 일본 제품일 건데 그런 뭐 이렇게 슈퍼마리오 같은 게임 여기서부터 보글보글 슈퍼마리오 갤러그 이런 게임이 제가 인생 태어나서 처음 접한 게임들이었습니다.
I Love Uv is a very well-remembered figure from the StarCraft scene, mostly known for his years of dominance while playing for SK Telecom T1. It was here that he innovated many strategies for the Terran race that would be used for the rest of the life of StarCraft. To put in perspective how impactful his play was, people still put up old forum posts today detailing the history of his matches and accomplishments throughout his career. But if you ask Uv about his legacy as a player, you don't really get the answer you'd expect.
그런 말이 있어요. 내가 뭐 자기가 내가 저 때는 되게 잘했었다. 그러니까 과거를 회상하게 되죠. 그 말 뜻이 현재가 과거에 비해서 이제 못 나가고 있다라는 저는 반증이라고 생각을 해서 과거의 유물들은 좀 지우는 편입니다. 그래서 집에서 우승 트로피나 이런 것들을 버려요. 저는 제가 나이 들어서 진짜 죽기 직전에 추억하면 추억하지.
After about 4 or 5 years of playing competitively, I Love Uwe ended his playing career by taking over as the head coach for the team he used to play under. The StarCraft scene in Korea eventually waned and died shortly thereafter, and when SK Telecom disbanded their StarCraft team, I Love Uwe quickly moved on to the country's new esports fascination, League of Legends. 1 month after his dismissal from SK Telecom, Uwe became the head coach of the Afrika Freaks. This is a theme you're going to see throughout this documentary, Afrika hiring or signing players and coaches that are completely out of left field. It's not exactly normal for an expert in one game to be able to completely shift gears to an entirely new genre and have immediate success, but Uwe did exactly that. He's been the head coach of Afrika ever since his hiring 4 years ago. At this point, I Love Uwe has built 3 separate legacies for himself, one as a player, one as a head coach, and one in an entirely different game. I was curious what was more rewarding, being a pro player or a head coach, so when I sat down with a chance to interview him, I asked exactly that.
감독은 선수, 그러니까 구성된 선수단 전체를 이끌어서 우승을 해야 되는 그러니까 이겨야 되는 일이기 때문에 굉장히 어렵습니다. 그러니까 선수단 단합도 시켜야 되고 팀워크도 생각해야 되고 거기에 맞게 이제 실력도 평균적으로 상승할 수 있게 만들어야 되기 때문에 굉장히 어려운 일인데 저는 둘 다 경험해 본 입장으로서 저는 감독으로서 1승 1승이 굉장히 비교 불가 수준으로 굉장히 성취감이 큽니다.
And to his credit, that passion shines through incredibly well. All of his players can't stop themselves from bringing his name up when they talk about what it is that makes Afrika special.
그리고 제가 이렇게 아프리카 프릭스에서 4년이란 시간 동안 긴 시간 동안 제가 플레이를 할 수 있었던 것도 최현성 감독님의 그런 시스템과 그리고 플레이 방향성 그리고 제가 얼마나 더 프로 게이머로서 성숙할 수 있는지 아니면은 그냥 한 사람으로서 성숙할 수 있는지 제가 더 배울 수 있다고 느꼈기 때문에 한 팀에서 이렇게 오랫동안 플레이를 할 수 있는 것 같습니다.
그동안은 좀 비슷하다는 느낌을 받았었는데 이제 아프리카 팀은 최현성 감독님은 좀 다르신 것 같아요. 좀 더 간섭하시고 디테일하시고 약간 그런 느낌? 그걸 이제 좀 다르신 것 같아요.
저는 제가 선수 출신이라서 코칭을 할 때 이점이 있느냐 라고 하면 그게 내가 선수 출신이라서 내가 그걸 가지고 코칭을 하고 있나 라고 생각을 해본 적은 없어요. 하지만 주변 사람이 네가 프로 무대를 뛰어봤기 때문에 그 말을 할 때도 자신감을 갖고 얘기하는 그 부분이 있을 거다 라는 부분에서는 어느 정도 공감을 하긴 합니다. 근데 저는 100% 그렇게 생각은 하지 않고요. 그냥 그 분야에 얼마나 관심이 있고 깊이 있고 연구를 하고 노력을 했는지 그걸 얼마나 리더십을 발휘해서 전달할 수 있는지 선수단을 장악할 수 있는지 근데 선수단 장악은 굴림이 아니에요. 선수단을 이렇게 이끌어갈 수 있는지 그렇게 해석하면 될 것 같아요. 그런 부분들이 중요하지.
The idea of coaching players in competitive video games may sound a bit odd to outsiders, but it's an incredibly vital component to success. Like any sport, there is so much complexity to most games that pros need an authority figure to dictate strategies and set practice schedules, as well as to guide them on their road to improving as individuals.
어느 정도 재능이 있어도 그 어느 정도 길을 터주지 않으면 그 재능이 있는지도 모른 채 끝날 수도 있거든요. 나는 뭐 예를 들어 좌절할 수도 있고 그 재능을 알아봐 주는 것도 굉장히 중요한 일이라고 생각합니다. 재능이 있는지도 모르거든요. 사실 일반적으로 본인이 내가 어떤 재능인지 사실 개개인은 다 모르잖아요. 지금 아직도 저도 내가 무슨 재능이 있는지 잘 몰라요. 그런 것처럼 어떤 분야의 전문가가 있다면 너는 이 분야에 굉장히 전문가 뭐 전문성이 있네 굉장히 재능이 있네 이걸 알아봐 줄 수 있는 사람이 코칭 스태프라고 생각을 합니다. 뭐 위대한 선수를 S급 선수라고 할게요. S급 선수가 되기 위해서는 S급 선수의 문까지는 코칭 스태프가 데려갈 수는 있습니다. 근데 그 문을 열고 나가는 것은 선수가 해야지.
One of the most perplexing things about Uwe's coaching style, though, is the scouting process that he and the rest of his staff go through when it comes to players that they approach intending to sign. League of Legends nowadays is a game that's often criticized as being just a bunch of super teams, organizations that like to go out and pay as many former world champions as they can to get proven talent on their roster. This strategy has had hit or miss results, but generally speaking, winning in any sport isn't just about acquiring all the best players you can. But either way, Afrika doesn't bother with this idea.
사람은 누가 등 떠민다고 해서 성인인 이상 자기가 좋아하지 않는데 하지 않죠. 그래서 자기가 하고자 하는 의지, 열망 이게 전 제 1번으로 봅니다. 그게 없으면 아무리 재능이 뛰어나고 피지컬이 좋아도 이끌어 갈 수가 없고 그래서 저는 의지. 근데 저는 이거를 모든 분야 공통이라고 생각해요. 공부를 하든 뭐 요리를 하든 축구를 하든 농구를 하든 무언가를 하더라도 그걸 하고 싶은지 내가 이걸 잘하고 싶은지 얼마나 하고 싶은지 정상을 찍고 싶은지 이게 되게 중요합니다. 적당히 하고 싶다. 이 선수 가지고 정상을 노릴 수 없겠죠. 네. 사람이니까 1번은 마음가짐, 의지라고 생각합니다.
Most of the players Afrika approaches to sign are completely unknown names that are on no other team's radar. When they're scouting players, they are looking for rookies that have 1 star's worth of current skill and 5 star's worth of potential. The Freaks probably sign and play more rookies on their starting roster than anybody does in any competitive league in the world. This is true for current members of the team like Keen, who we've previously talked about, but there's also many other current and former players that Afrika has signed and developed into the players they are today. Mongli, who's on Vitality in Europe, Ruby, who's moved on to Rogue Warriors in China, and Summit, who's currently on Team Sandbox in Korea, are all players that started their careers as rookies who the Afrika Freaks took in, developed, and coached into the great stars they are today. Now, this draft and develop kind of mindset is something that's had mixed results for them in the past. They've yet to win the LCK or a world title, of course, but they've been able to do well enough domestically that they've stayed in Korea's top league and have never been relegated, all while keeping player salaries low so the team doesn't run into financial trouble. Still, up until this past year, the best accomplishment they've reached was second place at a few different events, or at least it was until this last 2019 offseason when they once again got a few more rookies together on their roster who helped them take down their first championship.
Afrika Freaks just way too far ahead. You have to shout out Fate and some of his shockwaves. They were brilliant, but they just weren't enough against the Elder Drake, against the Dragon Soul, and your Kesper Cup finalists do rampage their way through the sandbox base. Nexus turrets die, the Nexus will follow, and the Afrika Freaks will be your Kesper Cup 2019 champions.
우선 캐스파컵 우승이란 것 자체가 팀 자체 첫 우승이기도 하고 저에게 있어서 올해 가장 좋은 스타트를 알릴 수 있는 정말 큰 의미의 우승이었던 것 같고요. 하지만 그렇다고 해서 캐스파컵이 뭐 LCK 뭐 롤드컵보다 더 중요했다 뭐 이런 건 아니고 LCK 우승을 위한 첫 번째 첫 단추였기 때문에 저는 너무 중요하게 생각하고 있었습니다.
저는 개인적으로 캐스파컵 우승이 그렇게 큰 의미가 있다고 생각하진 않아요, 개인적으로.
Meet Jelly, my new favorite League of Legends pro. So Jelly first started playing competitive league in Korea's amateur scene and wouldn't get a chance to start for an LCK team for the first 4 years of his career, and what a long 4 years it was. He kicked everything off in 2015 when he played for a team called Hungry, who wasn't able to do much in the one tournament they entered. He then played for Dark Wolves in the Korean Challenger League, who would win the 2015 CK, but would fall flat, losing their promotion relegation series 3-1 against Incredible Miracle. In 2016, he played half the year for Dark Wolves and then half for Ever 8 Winners, who would barely, again, not qualify for LCK. At that point, he would then move into China to try and try his luck there as he joined the challenger team IN Gaming in 2017. They would perform even worse and ended up barely getting relegated from China's amateur league. It should be mentioned Jelly is a support main, which means he plays one of the least impactful roles in League of Legends, and to his credit, he had been playing incredibly well throughout this entire 3-year stretch. He just had nothing to show for it yet. His luck was about to change though, because just before 2018, he would finally get his big break as Afrika would sign him to their roster. He wouldn't start a game for them until 2019, but it wasn't long before he proved his worth as he would play as Afrika's main support for the campaign that won them the 2019 Kespa Cup, their first title ever. Although he clearly is aiming for a lot more than that. Jelly was actually the support player on Ever8 Winners at the same time the AD carry player Teddy was, which that should be a familiar name to League of Legends fans. As they played bot lane together, they managed to do so well that Teddy would be picked up by big name LCK teams, first Jhin Air, and then eventually the Dynasty SK Telecom T1. Here on T1, he made such a name for himself that many in the West crowned Teddy the best AD carry player in the world. Jelly, of course, wasn't quite so fortunate.
저는 이제 진성이랑 이제 테디랑 테디 선수랑 친해서 그때부터 되게 SKT1에서 잘하는 모습 보면서 되게 기분이 좋았고 이제 기분이 좋은 반면 이제 제가 부러운 마음을 가지고 나도 쟤처럼 열심히 해서 꼭 저런 무대 밟아보겠다 이런 동기부여도 같이 되면서 되게 좋은 점으로 작용했던 것 같아요.
From the time I got to spend with Jelly, I gotta say, he is one of the most nice and positive, friendly people you will ever meet in this life, which is incredible considering how long he had to wait to play for a top team. I should mention, the world of amateur League of Legends is incredibly brutal. Some players spend their entire careers stuck in these second-tier leagues, and it is not a glamorous job playing here. Most of these players hardly make any money, they get stuck in awful, abusive contracts, and there's hardly any way out. The absolute best case scenario that you can hope for as one of these players is some LCK team scouts you while you're playing well for a stretch of games and they end up giving you a tryout for their team. The only other good thing that can happen to you is winning promotion into the top league, where you have to then get walloped by pros for a year trying to not immediately get relegated again. Seeing someone who's been stuck playing for these amateur teams for almost their entire career so far, someone who's seen all his teammates get their big breaks while having to keep on waiting with no certainty that he'd ever get his own, that's gotta be a special kind of torture. For someone to emerge from that world completely unjaded, happy, and positive, I mean, that's a feat of incredible willpower. I wanted to ask Jelly, now that he's finally in Korea's top league, does it feel like you've hit your own big break and you can finally relax knowing that you've made it?
먼저 저는 여기 아프리카에 들어오기 전에 막 여기저기 팀을 돌아다니면서 그때 연습했던 그러니까 제가 2부 리그를 뛰었던 모든 연습량을 합쳐도 아프리카에서 했던 연습량을 못 따라갈 거예요 아마 그 정도로 확연한 차이가 있고 여기 와서 성장한 것들이나 배운 것들이 많아서 차이가 심한 것 같아요 저는 신인이라는 마음가짐을 가지고 있고 그리고 뭔가 그러니까 제 자리를 위협받는다는 느낌은 안 드는데 또 제가 잘한다고 생각은 하지 않고 있거든요. 그냥 주어진 상황에서 최대한 열심히 하고 제가 할 수 있는 걸 열심히 하는 게 최대 목표인 것 같아요.
Jelly is still a relatively new player in the competitive League of Legends scene, and since he's so new to the LCK, it's certainly possible he could struggle in this new high-pressure environment, or at least he could have if Afrika didn't go out this past offseason and sign Mystic to be his lane partner, a battle-tested League player who's been around for so long, he even has a wife and child.
그냥 완전 옛날에 제가 저 막 20살 이럴 때 그때 지금 와이프가 제 팬이었는데 그러다가 팬이라서 그냥 뭐 알고 지내다가 제가 나중에 좀 제가 만나자고 했어요. 일단 지금은 걔가 게임 못하니까 나중에 좀 크면은 커면 이제 말도 통하고 걔도 막 게임 할 줄 알게 되고 하면은 뭐 그때도 롤이 있을지 모르겠지만 롤이 있다면 뭐 롤도 좀 알려줄 수 있고 아니면은 아니라면 좀 다른 게임도 저는 같이 하면서 좀 친하게 지냈으면 좋겠어요 아들이랑. 저는 일단 출퇴근을 하기 때문에 만날 수는 있어요. 만나긴 하는데 보통 제가 집에 가면 다 자고 있으니까. 그리고 뭐 제가 뭐 퇴근하면은 뭐 빠르면 막 2시, 늦으면 막 4시까지도 되는데 이제 좀 제가 몸도 좀 피곤하고 가면 또 자고 있고 그래서 좀 아쉽다고 해야 되나?
One of the biggest household names in League of Legends communities is Team WE. Formerly known as World Elite, they're a Chinese team who's been active in the League scene since early Season 2. They have such a storied legacy that among other accomplishments, they managed to win IPL 5, which many older League fans consider the greatest tournament LoL's ever had. During their run of dominance, they also had one of the greatest AD carry players in all League's history, a Chinese veteran named Wei Zhao. China in general is known for having incredibly good AD carry players, so when Wei Zhao decided to retire and go into coaching, Team WE had an immense hole to fill on their roster. Whoever took over would be the follow-up act to a Hall of Fame legend, which not many people can handle that kind of pressure, but that new rookie AD carry would then also have to go up against some of the best bot lanes in the world every single regular season game. WE tried out a few different players, but eventually decided to give a chance to their academy player, a young Korean kid who went by the name Mystic. Mystic would then go on to rival Wei Zhao as the best AD carry WE ever had.
Mountain Dragon, multiple Barons, and OMG is still somehow alive.
Here we go. There's the wall, Icon separated.
He's split. Should just be the tower here, but we've actually just gone in for the full-on engage, and Mystic is at the back, free-firing onto the front line, and we're looking at SMLZ, but he's nowhere to be seen, and he's never going to be seen again as he gets taken out by Mystic. Ben's got a 4 here, but Icon, he used the ultimate for that.
Oh my god!
Quadra kill out for Mystic. A 5 runs for the hills, preventing the Penta. But WE will take this one.
And it just felt so easy. One mistake, but nah. They need that Penta. They see
right,
the gun.
All right, Condi, let's make this happen. We've got a couple seconds. Let's go onto the pad.
Get the Penta.
He's trying it. The Penta kill for Mystic.
My friends, that's how you end the game. WE takes it 2-0.
Mystic has racked up one of the most impressive careers a League of Legends player can have during his time on WE. He was the 12th player in LPL history to reach 1,000 kills in July of 2017. He was then the 5th player in LPL history to reach 1,500 kills in February of 2019. He's taken first place at the 2015 NEST Tournament, 2017 Rift Rivals, and more impressively than all, he won the 2017 Spring Split of the Chinese League as a part of a roster that many WE fans consider their best roster ever. This isn't even to mention the host of other second and third place finishes he's had, including a third, fourth place finish at the 2017 World Championships. Listing off his accolades like this probably doesn't do his career justice. Just try and keep in mind, China is known for its AD carry players. This is a region that's completely built around AD carries dueling each other and the entire rest of the team playing to support them. Mystic has had to play up against players like iBoy, Uzi, Jackie Love, Imp, and LWX, all of which are world-class players, some of which world champions. Yet in spite of the toughest competition imaginable, Mystic outplayed them all. At the end of the 2017 season, WE went on a streak of failure and mismanagement. The team performed poorly at one tournament, which management responded by making roster changes, which then caused more poor performances. After spending 3 years of having a steady roster that gave consistently good results, they turned into a bit of a mess, shuffling rosters, signing and releasing players all over the place. The only consistently good thing they had was Mystic. Even at this point though, during the 2019 Spring Split, Mystic managed to carry this team kicking and screaming into an unexpected playoff berth. This was considered such a big accomplishment, it earned him not third, not second, second, but first team All-Pro for the spring season as voted on by media, commentators, and industry professionals. Even with all the talent China has at the 80 carry position, he was the best 80 carry in the region that season while playing for one of the worst teams. Mystic, by all means, has had a legendary career so far and is well within his rights to retire and look back on his accolades with joy, but even now, he is still not satisfied. Third place at Worlds just isn't enough for him.
아니, 제가 그래도 롤드컵을 나가보긴 했는데 저는 뭔가 하면은 좀 최정상급은 아니어도 좀 어느 정도는 내고 싶거든요. 막 굳이 롤이 아니어도 다른 게임 할 때도 그랬거든요. 그래서 지난 제가 지금까지 낸 성적 중에 제일 높은 게 롤드컵 4강인데 제가 원하는 건 롤드컵 우승이지만 그래도 결승까지라도 올라가 보고 싶네요. 지금 당장은 은퇴하고 싶은 생각이 없습니다.
It should be mentioned, Afrika are a somewhat middle-class organization in the LCK. The company that owns the team, Afrika TV, are a Korean live-streaming website that's very popular within the country. The name Afrika stands for Anyone Can Freely Cast, in case you were wondering. They've grown to incredible heights in recent years as a company, as the world of gaming has exploded. Just last summer, they were ranked 4th on Forbes' list of Asia's 200 best under a billion. But even so, they still aren't the richest organization in the LCK. Some of the teams they go up against are owned and operated by multi-billion dollar conglomerates who, if you ever walk the streets of South Korea, you'll see their names plastered everywhere. So how does Afrika compete and manage to do so well in spite of their smaller budget? Well, they love to sign players that the rest of their competition passes up on, essentially their Billy Bean and the Oakland A's from Moneyball. Moneyball was a book and subsequent movie that talked about how the poorest team in American baseball managed to outwit and beat incredibly rich opponents. They did so by creating a team of undervalued misfits, signing players that other organizations were overlooking for superficial reasons. That's exactly what the Afrika Freaks are doing to construct their rosters in the LCK today. We've already mentioned how they like to take risks on rookies that the rest of the LCK passes up on, but this goes way beyond that. For example, in Korea, every single player who's ever played in the LCK has always been Korean. That may sound obvious since it is the Korean League, but it's not as simple as that. Every other league in the world routinely looks overseas and brings in what are called import players, players who are not residents of the region they're playing in. There are some limits to how many imports you can have on one team, but this is something you can physically do. It's not against the rules. If you find some incredibly talented top laner in Turkey, you're still allowed to sign him and have him play for your organization, even if you're in North America. Traditionally, Korean teams have never done this. Maybe it's because they don't need to, as the country has such a huge local talent pool that teams can draw from, but this homogenous player base is likely one of the reasons the region has seen a decline in recent years. When Korea first got access to League of Legends, they developed a place style that today, 8 years later, most teams still play the exact same way. Meanwhile, other regions like China and Europe have spent recent years innovating and creating new, unheard-of strategies, which they're now using to consistently beat Korean teams that have no idea what they're supposed to do against them. Not having foreign players in the region to challenge the Korean way of thinking has undoubtedly contributed to the downfall of the region. Yet Afrika, thinking outside the box as they always do, refuse to conform to even this unwritten rule. As recently as the 2019-2020 offseason, they reached out to a well-known European superstar and attempted to sign him for the upcoming season. Due to NDAs, I'm not permitted to disclose the name of the player in question, but it would have been incredibly big news were it to come to fruition. To my knowledge, this is the only time a Korean team has ever even attempted to sign a non-Korean player, and apparently the deal came very close to happening. But sadly, at the 12th hour, things fell apart as the language barrier ended up killing the idea. Mystic, however, was the other innovative acquisition that did end up working out in the 2019 offseason. You may wonder how an established superstar like him could be considered an unconventional signing, but in Korea, most teams likely wouldn't take a chance on him.
일단 좀 젊은 친구들한테 좀 더 유리한 것 같긴 해요. 일단 그러니까 솔직히 나이가 아니라 좀 게임을 한 기간이라고 해야 되나요? 뭐 나이도 나이인데 일단 어리고 게임을 오래 접하지 않은 친구들은 좀 더 막 열정적으로 할 수 있는 것 같고, 비교적으로 제가 나이를 먹고 게임도 오래 했다고 막 열정적이지 않다는 게 아니라 좀 상대적으로 그런 것 같다고 생각해요. 또 실제로도 제가 좀 비교적 제가 나이가 많은 편이기도 하고요.
Here you can see a chart showing the ages of active LCK players plotted alongside how many players currently fall into each age demographic. As you can tell, there's less than a handful of players above the age of 25, and the teams who do sign these guys to their roster, they're mostly bad teams, currently at the bottom of the league. I mean, they might just be making these signings as a desperate attempt to not get relegated. Afrika are one of the only teams who don't hold these kinds of stereotypes, though. Their criteria for signing players is very different.
자기가 하고자 하는 의지, 열망, 이게 전 제 1번으로 봅니다.
It's reasons like this that a middle-class team like Afrika can sign legendary AD carry players like Mystic, because for all of Mystic's accomplishments, he's currently 25 years old. As insane as it may sound, Korean teams aren't interested in signing an athlete that's 25 years old. I mean, what are they running, a retirement home? Well, at time of recording, Mystic is finishing out his first split with Afrika, and he's looking like an absolute steal. I'd call him one of the top three AD carries in LCK right now, a bona fide superstar, and if other teams aren't regretting signing him by now, then I don't know what they're doing.
He's trying to find one back, but it's Mystic that grabs the first kill in the fight, and Teddy goes down also. Now Kana trying to fight against Keen, who he hasn't been able to all game, so we know exactly how that one goes, and a triple kill comes forward from Mystic.
Not every one of Afrika's signings was quite so popular though, and for my money, Afrika's new mid laner Fly has had possibly the most underappreciated career of any League of Legends pro out there.
어렸을 때부터 7살인가 때부터 그 동네 시골에 살았었는데 동네 형들이랑 막 그때 PC방이 있었거든요, 자그마하게. 그때부터 계속 게임을 해왔던 것 같고요. 프로게이머는 제가 고등학교 되고부터 그냥 원래 전부터 생각은 하고 있었는데 그냥 이렇게 게임하면서 살아야겠구나, 나는 게임을 할 수밖에 없는 몸이구나 라고 깨달아서 고등학생 때 그때부터 좀 진지하게 했던 것 같아요.
What does your family think about your career and accomplishments?
처음에는 물론 반대했죠. 근데 지금은 너무 귀찮아요. 계속 간섭해가지고 엄마가 막 가족들도 막 계속 경기 뭐 챙겨보고 그러는데 자꾸 맨날 이래라 저래라 해가지고 좀 불편합니다. 이게 최근에 또 저희 엄마가 커뮤니티를 막 보기 시작했단 말이에요. 근데 그 커뮤니티가 좀 젊은 사람들이 보는 건데 엄마가 그거 어떻게 알아가지고 그것까지 봐가지고 좀 불편해요, 진짜. 그만 좀 봤으면 좋겠어요.
Cheongnam Techno University is a private technical university in Gokseong County, South Cheonla. They offer a series of undergraduate degrees in various different fields, international tourism, IT, physical education, etc. But they also got pretty involved in the world of esports. For a while, they ran two competitive League of Legends teams that competed in a few of the events from League's early days. The two teams in question were the CTU Pathos and CTU Revolt. The latter of which came to be surprisingly relevant, as it had a pretty star-studded roster that featured both Mystic and Fly, who would begin their pro careers here as they signed together in July of 2013. This was the start of Mystic's storied career and aforementioned success, but for Fly, he's had a much harder journey.
Thank you.
has played for a total of 9 different organizations in his 7-year career before joining Afrika. For the first 8 of those organizations, he spent less than a year at each of them. He's had to pick up and live in a total of 3 different countries over that period of time, which this cannot be a life that's easy peasy and lets you develop fully as an athlete without any bumps in the road. Maybe the best team Fly's played for so far was KT Rolster, who he joined in 2016. During that year's spring and summer split, KT placed top 3 and made it to the summer playoffs to potentially win the Korean title and go to the World Championship. After beating Samsung Galaxy 3-0 and reverse sweeping their arch rivals SK Telecom in the semifinals, KT were poised to take the tournament with a roster that everyone was celebrating.
Get punished yet, actually is able to make it out. Duke. Now the Guardian Angel's gonna get popped. Snap back from Duke as he's trying to stick it to the back line.
They're on the Nexus!
They're on the Nexus, and KT Rolster! They're gonna do it! They take down SK Telecom in the reverse sweep, bringing it back 3 games in a row, and they are going to the finals on the 20th to face against the ROX Tigers.
But sadly, because it's KT, they would lose out to the ROX Tigers in a 3-2 set, just barely missing out on glory.
With the 그 당시에는 물론 아쉽고 막 그랬겠지만 지금은 이제 딱히 미련 가지 않고 그냥 뭐 그러려니 한 것 같아요. 그런 운명이었겠거니. 네.
It wasn't until 2018 when Fly joined the other LCK team, Gen G, did he get to spend more than a year with a single roster. This was a team that actually played pretty well and managed to qualify for the World Championship that year, but Fly would mostly play as a substitute behind their starting mid laner Crown. When Gen G had to trim their roster down to 6 players before heading to Worlds, Fly ended up not making the cut and left the team shortly thereafter. This was the World Championship where Gen G would give the worst performance a Korean team ever had given, getting knocked out in the group stage. We have a word in the West for people like Fly, journeyman. The definition of journeyman is a worker or sports player who's reliable but not outstanding, and I think a lot of people would classify Fly's career as such. Throughout his time in professional play, he has never been outstanding, but he's been reliable, which is why he's always able to find a new team when his time on another ends. That word though, journeyman, I mean that's a word that describes Fly very well in its etymology. Fly is someone who has always been on a journey, from one team to another, from one experience to another, even from one side of the globe to the other, he has never not been on a pilgrimage.
솔직하게 말하면 그냥 되는 대로 살아가지고 왜냐하면 남들은 그러니까 어린 나이에 이제 저는 뭐든지 경험해보면 좋다고 이제 생각을 하고 있고 그래서 되게 많은 경험들을 했었거든요. 그래서 만족하고 있습니다.
Afrika, being the team that they are, held no prejudices against Fly and signed him to be their starting mid laner this past offseason. The reaction of their fans in Korea, as well as their fans in the West, were mixed at best. Which, I don't know, I always feel bad when I see comments like these, when you're a new signee coming into a sports organization, hoping to make a difference, to be a positive impact, and take your new team all the way to a championship. I mean, it's just got to be demoralizing when your new fans respond like this. One fact a lot of people don't know about Fly is he originally started off as a streamer in the world of League of Legends. He streamed on a site called Downpot, which is one of the 3 big streaming services in Korea behind Afrika and Twitch. Now, normally, popular streamers in the world of gaming can make much more money than pro players do. I mean, streamers can make 8 grand playing a game for 30 minutes to an hour, whereas pros have to spend 12 hours a day practicing. They have very little time for personal activities, they sometimes have no life outside of the game that they play. This is a much harder job for a salary that's oftentimes much less than that of a streamer. And to his credit, Fly gave up his cushy streaming job to pursue this dream. He does it no matter what anyone says. His old stream viewers are actually known for popping in to LCK streams, and anytime they see him playing, they call him our son, saying things like, "Hey, look, our son is doing so well today." You know, Fly was probably one of my favorite people to interview, in spite of the fact that the world of esports is oftentimes populated by kids, I mean children, incredibly young adults. Fly seemed matured. He's been through experiences that nobody else will ever go through, and is adamant that his story here isn't finished. Before I left, I had to ask one final question. If you could give advice to the next young amateur League of Legends player who wants to go pro, what would you say to him?
일단 한 팀에 좀 오래 있어봐라. 딱 이 정도.
If you're a fan of League of Legends, you should know by now that we've talked about players who main each of the different roles that exist in the game, except for one. We still need to talk about Afrika's jungler. Jungling is one of the more important and impactful roles in League, and Afrika has a veteran jungler that's probably a familiar face to some of you, but if you haven't heard of him before, let me be the first to introduce you to Spirit.
My mom watching Life of Legend, you know? She say, why your teammate say Korean bad word, you know? She blame me. She buy.
Stop! Stop!
Spirit began his League of Legends career at the young age of just 17 years old. He was one of the first Prodigy superstar players to emerge from the Korean scene, which earned him the nickname Crazy High School Student. His career would really kick off on the up-and-coming team MVP Blue, who eventually got sponsored by Samsung, becoming Samsung Blue. This roster had some incredibly legendary first-generation Korean players on it, such as Acorn, Deft, and even the mythical Dade, someone so talented he now has an award named after him. Samsung Blue ended up being one of the best teams in League's first four seasons, and even won the Korean League in the 2014 Spring Split. Right now, Spirit is the only member of Afrika who has previously won a Korean championship, but just like his head coach, he doesn't really seem to care about his legacy at all.
제가 생각하기에 이제 과거는 과거일 뿐이고 현실에 더 높은 가치를 주고 싶고요. 그렇기 때문에 이번 우승은 정말 더 큰 가치였던 것 같고 또 LCK 우승을 더 하고 싶어지는 이유이기도 한 것 같습니다. 제 개인적인 생각으로는 올해 프로를 한 것 자체가 큰 뭐 성과라고 할 수는 없을 것 같아요. 그저 그런 선수로 오래 했을 수도 있는 거고 이름 있는 선수로 오래 했을 수도 있는 건데 저는 그냥 당장에 그냥 오래 한 선수가 아니라 이름 있고 그 커리어도 좋고 뭐 지금의 페이커 선수처럼 누가 들어도 알 법한 선수가 되는 게 제 목표입니다.
Spirit would conclude his time on Samsung with a third, fourth place finish at the 2014 World Championship before participating in what came to be known as the Great Korean Exodus. This was when a gigantic wave of Korean superstars left the region as foreign teams began offering huge contracts to use their talents all over the world. People were starting to use that import rule to snag as many Koreans as they could, and Spirit was one of them. He would first leave to go off and play in China, playing alongside Mystic for Team WE for a little while, although he would never win the Chinese League. After one disappointing season in particular, he would part ways with WE and left to go off to Europe of all places, where he ended up playing for possibly the most historic Western esports organization that exists, Fnatic.
우선 Fnatic에서 제가 팀 생활을 1년 하고 왔었는데 그건 정말 행복했던 추억들이었던, 행복했던 기회였고 행복했던 기억들이었던 것 같아요. 그 서양의 새로운 뭐 문화, 그리고 제가 그동안에 한국과 중국에서만 플레이했었는데 뭔가 그 선수들의 플레이 스타일, 뭔가 그 자유분방한 분위기 그런 것도 경험해 볼 수 있어서 너무 좋았고 제가 느끼기에 가장 한국 팀과 유사하고 가장 뭐랄까 한국 팀 같았던 그런 팀은 유럽에 이제 제가 있었던 Fnatic이 가장 그런 시스템과 제일 흡사했던 것 같아요. 제가 바라는, 제가 추구하는 시스템과 흡사했던 것 같고 그 중에서도 특히 코치로 있었던 데일러가 그 부분에 가장 많은 기여를 한 것 같고 또 덕분에 제가 너무 많이 배워서 아직도 항상 감사하게 생각하고 있고요.
Spirit became a fan favorite on Fnatic during his time there for a lot of different reasons. Namely, he's a really cool guy, but he also put considerable effort to learning English and connected with Western fans in a way that no other Korean pro really ever did. Keep in mind, up until this point, most Westerners saw Koreans as just League of Legends machines, robots who play the game all day and who get incredibly good at it, but like robots, they don't have much character or distinguishing personalities between themselves. Seeing Spirit giving all these interviews and streaming to his fans quickly made him a new favorite Korean pro for many Western players out there. However, Fnatic at this time would see a decline in performance compared to what many of their fans were used to. They would place well at a few third-party tournaments, taking a 3rd-4th place finish at IEM Cologne and a 2nd place finish at the IEM Season 10 World Championship, but during the official spring and summer seasons for Europe, they would have much more mediocre finishes and would miss out on the World Championships that year. The problem was too many players on the roster had too many different playstyles. The Korean imports Gamsu and Spirit were playing completely different styles from Fnatic's older carries, Febiven and Reckless, and eventually Spirit also struggled to stay happy while playing in the region.
근데 그럼에도 제가 이제 한국으로 돌아오게 된 이유는 아무래도 해외가 뭐 중국은 가깝고 뭐 유럽은 14시간 정도 비행기를 타고 가야 돼가지고 너무 멀더라고요. 그러다 보니까 가족들과 있는 시간도 없어서 점점 좀 힘들었고 향수병 같은 게 왔었고 그리고 여기서 오래 하다가는 뭔가 제가 너무 가족들과 멀어질 것 같은 그런 느낌이 좀 들어서 아 나는 무조건 한국에서 해야겠다라는 생각을 했습니다.
It was at this time that Spirit decided to return to Korea after spending 3 years abroad. He was a pretty decorated veteran from his days on Samsung, but he actually hadn't won a championship or taken first place in any competition since those good old days in Korea, so it wasn't a surefire thing that he'd have a ton of offers to start for high-level teams. But I think you can see where this is going by now. Afrika held no prejudices and signed him right away to be their new starting jungler. At first, there were some growing pains playing for this new team. When Afrika signed Spirit, they were also playing with a top laner named Marin, who consistently demanded that his jungler always come top lane and help win his lane matchup in-game. This happened seemingly every single match, and didn't give much room for Spirit to have creativity within his own play. The strategy did work for a little while, and it got Afrika some wins against top teams, but they would always just finish middle of the pack at the end of the season, so after a while, Marin would leave the team, and it just so happened that the time that he left was when Afrika had just scouted that young Ever8 Winners top laner, Keen. Well, Keen doesn't really need much help top lane, and it's been a much nicer experience being a jungler for him, so ultimately the move left everyone much, much happier. Sadly though, Spirit has had a fairly tumultuous time in the past year with the organization. After Afrika had their disappointing World Championship in 2018, they returned to Korea and had an even rougher spring season. They would finish 8th in the LCK, meaning they just barely didn't get relegated from the league, and this scare caused the coaching staff to pull some pretty drastic roster changes, which ultimately ended up with Spirit being benched the entirety of the summer split.
제가 거의 경쟁 뭐 서브라고 하기도 뭐한 뭐 경쟁도 못 해보고 그렇게 제가 시즌 아웃이 됐었는데 그럴 때는 되게 처참하고 비참하고 좀 많이 속상했었는데 그조차도 저는 좀 올해 더 잘하기 위한 발판이었다고 생각하고. 그렇기 때문에 서브로 있었을 때도 되게 더 긴장감 가지고 더 죽어라 노력했던 것 같습니다.
But like Keen, Spirit is an incredibly grateful and loyal person. He holds no ill will towards the team or coaches or the organization as a whole, and when I asked what he wanted to do when his playing career had come to a close, he gave an answer that reflected that.
만약 제가 은퇴를 하게 된다면 제일 처음으로는 군대를 일단 다녀와야 되겠고 군대 문제를 해결하고 난 후에는 개인적으로는 아프리카 프릭스라는 팀에 조금 더 기여할 수 있는 그 어떤 일이라도 하고 싶어요. 왜냐면 4년이란 지금까지만 해도 4년인데 4년이란 시간 동안 정말 많은 일이 있었고 많은 정도 들었고 또 저에게 많은 배움을 준 팀이기 때문에 저도 좀 보답하고 싶은 마음이 있습니다.
It should be mentioned there is much more to the Afrika Freaks than these players alone. There's a coaching staff who works with iLovu of consisting of first-generation LoL legends like Vinyl Cat, the former Najin support player and decorated veteran in his own right. There's also Actscene, who even won an IEM championship before he went into coaching and became the technical mastermind who birthed the monster that was the 2018 Kingzone Dragon X roster. This team was heralded as the next big dynasty who ironically would beat Afrika in the grand finals to win their very first championship. Also, in addition to every one of the five players we've mentioned, Afrika has alternates for each and every position, rostering 10 starters for the LCK, as well as having an academy team who are all impressive players in their own right. It's not easy running a professional gaming organization, and we have only skimmed the surface of the brilliant minds you'll find piloting Afrika. Whether it's storied veterans, up-and-coming rookies, or the legendary coaches, Afrika has some of the smartest minds that you will find in the esports industry. The LCK's 2020 spring season kicks off in just a couple of days, and that might be some of the worst timing you could imagine. Currently, the coronavirus has just had its first few dozen cases confirmed in South Korea, and with the gift of hindsight, we know that things are only going to be getting worse. Many sports leagues around the world will be postponed or canceled, and the LCK is no different. As a first step to combating the virus, public attendances will be banned for matches. Only players, coaches, and media teams will be allowed at the LCK studio, LOL Park. And this will only be after taking the temperature of everyone who wants to enter first. Eventually, individuals will be required to wear masks while there, and only one media team will be allowed on stage at a time. Early in the week before Afrika's opening day set, the team is boot camping at their team house, getting as many last-minute scrimmages in as they can. Afrika actually doesn't live in a traditional gaming house, but rather a series of apartments stationed in the many high-rise buildings that sit between the beautiful mountains of Korea. There's two apartment buildings that house the Freaks, one being strictly for sleeping, eating meals, and general life living, whereas the other is exclusively for the hours and hours of practice. The team is currently scrimmaging against Damwon Gaming and is out to a very early lead, getting every opponent inhibitor by the 25-minute mark. I've been asked to blur the screens of players as scrim leakage is a very serious issue in Korea. While the team is playing, a coach is going through the replay as it happens and is taking notes on everything that occurs in-game, good and bad. This particular scrim, Afrika would end up losing the match in spite of their early lead. Keen, in particular, had a bit of a rough play as he's adjusting to the new Soraka top lane strategy that recently became meta. Now, a coach will go through what went wrong and try and give lessons to the team, telling each player what they did well and what they need to improve on. The coach commands such authority and respect from the players, you would think that he was their dad. Currently, the team is practicing with one of their alternate players, SS, formerly known as Saul, who's an AD carry player that's been with the team since 2018. I shouldn't call him an alternate, actually. iLoveUV is emphatic that there are no starters and there are no subs on this team. Whoever plays better in practice will always get the chance to start come match day. Currently, Mystic is practicing with the Academy team, and it appears SS will be playing for the first match of Afrika's opening best of three series. The opening day set means a lot to the organization. The team has been practicing for months, and all of it is going to pay off in just a few days, hopefully. There's a Korean superstition that if you leave your house in the morning and see a crow or raven, then that's a bad omen and your day is about to be rough. But if you see a magpie, good things are ahead.
번 더 확인 부탁드리고 막간 소유자 보험이 가장 핵심이기 때문에 이거에 대해서 일단 간단하게 설명을 드리면 자리에서 내 개인
Everyone is nearly ready for their match now, but for the time being, they'll be hanging out in the green room. It's here that they'll eventually be called onto the stage, but only after the first series of the day finishes. Currently, Team APK are facing off against Sandbox Gaming for their own opening day LCK series. Sandbox has already taken game one, so if they win this next match, Afrika will then be rushed to the stage to kick their season off. Afrika's first matches are against Team Griffin, a team who finished first in the regular season standings last year, but who were broiled in controversy in the offseason. Differences between the head coach of the team and higher-ups in the company caused a huge public fight that showed just how awful the organization was treating some of its players. For example, there was one contract in particular that was leaked to the press that suggested Griffin allegedly pressured one of their players into signing this deal, which included such lovely clauses as, if the player is sick and unable to make it to practice for more than 30 days, he can be fired immediately. If that happens, the player won't be able to sign with another team for a full year. Not to mention, if this player plays badly at any point, Griffin are, again, allowed to terminate his contract at any time. Things became such a horrible hot mess that a Korean senator even ended up getting involved with the situation. I think it's safe to say that Griffin are kind of the polar opposites of Afrika when it comes to the two organizations and how they treat their players. Due to the controversy, Griffin ended up losing many of their star players and coaching staff who were credited with their previous success, so nobody really knew what the team would end up doing this year. Were they still the scary Griffin that dominated the LCK before, or were they now somehow beatable? Either way, it was time to find out.
To get himself down here. Irozo taking way too much damage to start this one off. In he comes and Fly decimates the Thresh. Everyone on Afrika is there to leash the double kill into the Drake. Easy as you like. Hello, board. This is a very aggressive one from Sword. Jelly in position. Ornhorn coming down. Does nail onto a couple of members, but great CC timing from Jelly to deny the recall. And he can't even searing charge. Afrika punish Sword to no end. Time to get into this dragon pit area as Keen getting off towards the side. The culling nowhere near being completed just yet. As far as that cooldown, we're looking for the Cloud Soul. Ornhorn comes in. It is secured, so we have Cloud Soul for Afrika. But can they win the fight? The answer from Jelly is no. There's the Dawning Shadow. Lots of damage. Afrika just getting torn apart, obliterated. And now Spirit, once again, the last man standing. Fly down to Tarzan's in position. They are going to give him a chance to come in and steal, but the barrel doesn't get him over the wall. He's still in the pit. It's down to 600, but Spirit does lock it down, and Tarzan is going to fall. By the grace of the Elder Drake, Afrika have managed to find themselves a Baron as well, and now Jelly's on the hunt for another hook. In goes Fly, the hook is going to land, and Yukal has no chance. Haymaker does do a fair bit of work, and he tries to suplex his way out, but there's the flash in from Spirit, and they lock him down as well. Androm does come in, straight in towards that Nexus. He wants it, as Yukal's going to get taken down in the trade, and Fly is even going to survive. Sword by himself, but the Nexus is being focused, and Afrika steal game one from a Griffin that found the mid-game team fights that their comp needed and then couldn't close it out in the end.
As I sat there watching the matches with Afrika's staff, I saw how stressed they were. All of their effort preparing the team boiled down to this. It was out of their hands, and all they could do was sit and watch.
So there's much more grace period granted to them before Griffin.
Oh, there's the flash cataclysm. Two people stuck in it. As Tarzan is going to safeguard his way out. Irobe not going to be so lucky. That box is for his own funeral. Picking that one up. That's the knockup onto Yukao, though, put into the gravity field. Oh, the equalizer lined up onto iRobe in the back line while they're dealing with the Ornn. Really beautiful coordination there from Afrika, and Fly is delivered a blue buff as well.
Fighting off a little bit more than they can chew. They are lined up for a pretty good equalizer.
And a slicing maelstrom. The equalizer does come in.
Hello?
He has flash. He can flash whenever he wants. It's the rumble! Steals the ult! Steals the Baron with an equalizer! That is ridiculous. Finally, Keen flashes in. The exhaust is there, but Griffin have well and truly botched this one. Good night, Yukao. He's going to have another extended look at it before he dies in the gravity field. And Afrika actually salvaged this. It looks like Anoa's the double kill comes in for the Aphelios. The Chaos Storm doing so much work as Yukao trying to soak it as best he can, but the death ray doesn't get that work done. Mystic off to the side is untouched, trying to take down five members as Zord
the kiting.
Can he actually do it here as Fly on his own gravity field? The hook lands, but he has the QSS. Death ray comes back. Double kill.
Oh my god!
Mystic secures the kill in the end. Now Viper's trying to be the god, but he's gonna go down. I roam the ace for Mystic. Welcome to the LCK. We're glad to have you here. Well, Kane has been brought out of the fight. He's in the death drum. Now has the slicing maelstrom as the victor takes down Tarzan. Spirit dealing with more as we've got a triple kill already. Could this be the penta for Fly, stolen out of nowhere? His AoE damage just ridiculous as Yukao is going to be his next target. Oh no, Viper. Nothing he can do there as Jelly is going to pick up another one. A quadra kill for Fly to finish off the 2-0 for Afrika Freaks. Griffin made them work pretty damn hard for it, but eventually they will be tying up top spot in the LCK with Sandbox.
They did it. Afrika had won and kicked off their season as good as they possibly could have with a 2-0 sweep. The team was in high spirits when they returned to the green room and were eager to do a live stream for their fans, who of course couldn't be there to celebrate with them in person. The following weeks wouldn't be such smooth sailing for the team though, as Afrika would manage to win or lose almost every series they played in incredibly close 2-1 sets for the first half of the spring split. This meant dropping games or losing sets to some of the worst teams in the league, but it also meant they beat some of the title contenders out there and suggested that they could maybe make a run for the LCK title themselves. Halfway through the spring split, they were in fourth place, positioned to make the playoffs fairly easily, but that's when the corona pandemic really started to ramp up. On March 2nd, both the LCK and Challengers Korea suspended operations due to the rising number of coronavirus cases in the country. Both leagues would resume play 3 weeks later, with matches now taking part online, but I'm not sure if it was the hiatus or the new non-live environment. However, it seems Afrika just weren't able to adjust. They'd go on a pretty big losing streak to a point where they would finish the spring season in 6th place, which was just on the outside of the playoffs looking in. They should still be positioned to make a run for their first LCK title in the summer season, as their roster remains incredibly strong. But either way, this whole ordeal has really kind of reminded everybody of something. The world of esports is incredibly brutal. For the players, it's downright ruthless. Compared to traditional sports, where plenty of athletes have 15 to 20 year long careers, in competitive gaming, you have maybe 6 years, maybe upwards of 10 if you're one of the greatest players of all time, but that's it. 6 to 10 years to make as much money as you can from your talents, to build a career and leave a legacy behind. Just a fraction of your life where every season matters, and where seeing one season lost to something that's completely out of your control has to be insanely heartbreaking. But things aren't much better for the organizations and teams either. It's an open secret in esports that almost all teams across all games lose money right now. Competitive gaming is not a profit-generating business, it's just a venture capitalist thing that's fairly brutal at the moment. I mean, this is a world where one bad season can kick you out of a league and kill off your team for good, where even if you manage to scrape by and stay in a league for a long period of time, you need to win consecutive championships over and over and over to even have a chance of getting a fan base. It's no wonder organizations are always trying to build super teams and do things by the book in the safest way possible. This is a world where making a single error in just one season can kill off your team and dissolve any future you potentially had. Naturally, it would be expected that all teams teams play it safe and keep things ordinary, so it's honestly a miracle that a team like Afrika even exists. A team who's prepared to take the time to sign and develop players who won't reach their full potential for years to come. A team who's willing to take on older veterans when the rest of the league only cares about young superstars. In this do or die business, the fact that there's a team who's willing to give second and third chances to journeyman players who everyone else has already given up on, the fact that a team like that even exists is nothing short of incredible. The Afrika Freaks are truly anything but ordinary. Although the LCK has returned by now, the nature of this recent pandemic has obviously thrown the fragility of the world of esports to the forefront of everyone's minds. So before I ended my time with the Afrika team, I wanted to ask some of the players one final question. When your time in esports is done, what do you want to do for the rest of your life?
가사?
그건 저도 잘 모르겠어요. 아마 근데 뭐 지금 현재로서는 제가 가장 잘하기도 하고 제일 좋아하는 일이기 때문에 이쪽 게임 쪽으로 나갈 것 같긴 한데 전 뭔가 횟집 차려보고 싶네요. 제가 물고기 영상 보는 걸 좋아해서.
아 저요? 저는 예전에 어떤 제가 어디 외국 그 미국 어디 기자분이었는데 뭐 이렇게 물어보더라고요. 비전이 뭐냐? 그래서 제가 비전이 없었어요. 그럼 창피하더라고요. 그래서 거기서 막 지어냈죠. e스포츠 업계가 이제 지금은 태동기나 이렇게 저변 확대를 하는 기간이지만 이 문화를 즐겼던 세대가 결정권자가 되는 세대가 오면 굉장히 이 판이 굉장히 진보된, 그러니까 과학의 진보와 밀접한 연관이 있고 그래서 같이 좀 IT 분야니까 계속 같이 성장할 거라고 생각을 해서 한 20, 30년 뒤에는 이 문화를 즐겼던 사람 중에서도 대통령도 나올 수 있고 뭐 CEO가 나올 수도 있고 그러면 지금보다는 굉장히 긍정적이고 밝은 면을 더 봐서 더 많은 투자가 이루어지고 더 많은 좋은 환경에서 할 일이 많을 거다. 그랬을 때 내가 거기에서 소임이 있지 않겠냐. 이게 비전이 돼버렸어요. 말하다 보니까. 근데 이제 그때는 그렇게 생각하고 그러려면은 여기서 e스포츠에서 어느 정도 계속 오랫동안 기여를 하면서 뭐 감독으로서는 좋은 성적과 좋은 커리어, 그다음에 뭐 좋은 후진 양성. 이런 것들을 잘 해야겠죠. 이제 그런 생각을 하면서 살고 있었는데 몸이 안 좋아서 그런지 점점 e스포츠판에서 언제쯤 내가 그만할까 이런 생각들을 좀 하게 되더라고요. 그러니까 그게 뭐냐. 그러니까 제가 선수 생활이 짧아요. 한 4년 했더라고요. 4년. 나머지는 코칭 스태프로 지내는데 코칭 스태프라는 건 뭐냐 쉽게 말하면 남의 인생을 보는 거예요. 남의 인생. 내가 20년은 아니지만 20년 근처를 e스포츠를 하다 보니 그 중에 선수 생활 4년 빼고 보니 한 15년 근처를 남의 인생을 보면서 살았더라고요. 근데 이게 좀 남의 인생을 보는 걸 이제 그만하고 싶다. 나도 그냥 내 인생 내 자기관리, 내 그걸 좀 보고 싶다. 나만을 위해 살고 싶다. 이런 생각이 좀 많이 듭니다, 요즘에는. 예. 그래서 또 생각은, 사람 생각은 어떻게 변할지 모르니까요. 근데 뭐 예. 저는 그런 생각은 하더라도 그거는 사적인 거고 공적으로 저는 아프리카 프릭스 감독으로서 2020년 선수단을 이끌어서 반드시 목표 한 바를 이루기 위해서 부철주야 노력을 하고 있습니다.
So, like.
말을 해놓고 수습까지 한 거죠, 제가.